Now I'd like to take a moment to talk to you about something that I've had the honor of talking and explaining to not just students who are thinking about this situation occurring, but actually those rescuers, whether that be professional or even people who were just helping neighbors or strangers or in certain cases, even their own family members. And that is, why didn't CPR work? Why did I do what I thought to be the right thing and the desired outcome not happen? And I think that's a fair question. It's certainly a question that I believe finds its roots in a misunderstanding of what CPR is. CPR has always been designed to be a time buyer. You see, when we do cardiac compressions, we're actually compressing this hollow organ we call the heart and its four chambers. And when in cardiac arrest, the heart is in either a fibrillatory state, which means it's wiggling around in a disordered fashion, or it's completely asystolic, meaning it's not contracting at all. And when it works normally, it's beating from top to bottom in an organized fashion with one-way valves. And it works perfectly to circulate oxygenated blood throughout the whole body very efficiently. But when a person suffers cardiac arrest, regardless of really what disorder is happening with the heart itself, the fact is the heart is not circulating oxygenated blood, and the body begins to die biologically. As soon as there's no breathing and no pulse, the person is in clinical death. They have already died. But it doesn't mean necessarily that they're going to remain that way. There's the difference between clinical death and biological death. CPR manually, artificially, tries to do its best to compress that hollow organ between the sternum and the spinal column. That's why we try to push it at least 2 to 2.4 inches deep, because we need to maximize that compression to make up for some type of circulation that's not occurring normally. But the reality of it is that even when we do picture-perfect CPR, I mean textbook, it's only a small percentage of what the body needs to survive. And therefore, CPR has never, ever really been equal to what we think of it sometimes to be, and that's artificial life support. We think, well, as long as we do the cardiac compressions, the body is alive. And it isn't that it dies until I stop doing compressions, and that's just not true. The fact of the matter is that CPR compressions are more acting like the brakes on a downhill freight train. The brakes are not going to stop the train from inevitably reaching the bottom of the hill, but they may slow it down a little bit. CPR does not stop the dying process. It simply slows down the biological cell death a little bit, in hopes that when we activate emergency medical services, 911, or call a code, and we bring in electrical therapy, automated external defibrillators or manual defibrillators, advanced life support, oxygenation, and drugs, that we can then somehow restore some form of more efficient and effective circulation of oxygenation to buy even more time so that we can fix the underlying reason that the person went into cardiac arrest in the first place. But the truth and the fact of the matter is that every person who's alive has a day to die. And we don't know when that is. As a licensed paramedic, I've done numerous cardiac arrests on infants, children, and adults. I've treated the very young and I've treated the very old. And some people that should have died survived, and some people that looked like they should have survived died. As a rescuer, all I knew was that it was their day to live unless they proved me wrong. But as far as I was concerned, I'm going to give them the best chance of survival I possibly could until they prove me otherwise. CPR was never meant to save lives directly. I used to joke around that I would write a book one day. CPR does not save lives. It just keeps people dead longer. And people go, what? That doesn't make any sense. What are you talking about? But that's the reality of it. And I think if we all would approach cardiopulmonary resuscitation with the understanding of the physiology and the cardiophysiology of what CPR really is versus what we perceive it to be, we would understand that when a person is in cardiac arrest and we do our best doing CPR, then the person remains dead, regardless of who they are. We, the rescuer, did not fail. The person simply remained dead for whatever reason. But that doesn't take away the fact that you still gave them the best chance of survival if survivability was going to be the outcome. And the one thing we know for sure is that if you do not try to do CPR, it's almost guaranteed this side of a miracle that one thing, and one thing only is for sure, and that is that they're rapidly going to go from clinical death to biological death and remain dead. And I say remain dead because it's important to understand people in cardiac arrest don't die, they just stay the way you found them. When you're asking yourself, well, then if CPR isn't all that, when CPR is less than a miracle drug, then is it really worth trying all that hard? I can tell you that in my street experience, that though I've never had a person complain to me that the CPR or the defibrillation hurt them when they were dead, I have had them come back in with their family and thank us for another holiday with their families. And as a father of six beautiful children and a husband, I can tell you that if I was in cardiac arrest, there is nothing more beautiful than knowing that my loved ones embraced me, cared for me, risked themselves, and did everything they could to save my life, regardless of the outcome. Now let's talk about strangers. Strangers that don't know the patient from anybody, and yet they care enough in the family of humanity to say, I don't know who you are, but you're special to somebody. I'm going to try to save your life. We don't know when a person can no longer hear when they go unconscious. We don't know at what point of unresponsiveness and unconsciousness a person can no longer sense or hear what's going on around them. There's a lot of research and it's unclear, but we do know that some people in cardiac arrest have come back out of cardiac arrest and they've actually been able to recount certain aspects of the cardiac arrest protocol. So they were able to hear certain things from time to time. Could you imagine how beautiful it must be that when either a family member or a stranger tries to save the life of another, that even if that person remains dead, that there's a chance that their last impression, their last experience was that of love. That someone would care enough to put themselves out there, outside their comfort zone, run the risk of failure for the sake of a chance to help you survive. That is the greatest gift that one human being can give to another. So failure is not in whether a person survives cardiac arrest or not. Failure is in whether or not we can understand that just trying is the success. If this has happened to you, I hope that this has brought some peace and clarity and healing to your life. And if you haven't had this happen, my hopes is that it prevents you from falling into the category of those people I hold so dearly that have reached out to me that are dealing with pain, agony, and guilt because CPR didn't seem to do what it was supposed to do, and they felt guilty for it. Go forth and rescue confidently, and be at peace.